So good evening, one and all. My name is Jeremy Travis. I am privileged to be the president of John Jay College of Criminal Justice, and I welcome all of you to this very important panel discussion on the issue of migration. We are delighted and honored to have the opportunity to host this discussion here at John Jay tonight. It really is very much in keeping with our interest in issues that affect the world, particularly from a security and human rights point of view, and there's probably no issue that's as elevated in importance and in complexity as the issue of migration. So the idea that we're having this discussion here at John Jay is really fitting for the mission of our college. I'm going to take a moment for an unabashed commercial announcement, sort of, who is John Jay College? Just, you know, people come here and they say, I've never been here before, I don't know who you are. Here's 30 seconds of who we are. John Jay College, liberal arts college, doctoral programs, master's programs, 15,000 students study here. We're part of the City University of New York, which means that we have a special role in our city and in our world in providing educational opportunities for those whose families can't afford to send them to Harvard and Yale and Wesleyan, but we're every bit as good as Harvard, Yale, and Wesleyan. A little pride there. And we have a special place in the world, is that we educate for justice. So our theme is that we educate for justice. We call ourselves fierce advocates for justice because we care about the world, we care about making it a better and safer place that respects human rights and human dignity and the rule of law. And on top of all that, our students, who you probably saw today, represent the diversity of New York City in terms of their place of birth, their race, and their ethnicity. Three-quarters of them students of color, 60% women, a quarter of them born in another country but grew up in New York. So we have a special place, we like to think, in thinking about the future of our city and our country and our world, and we take that very seriously, and we have lots of fun here. So where are we right now? We're at the Moot Court. So the Moot Court is part of our new building, a spectacular space. We're looking, looking east. And what if you came across the space with us from my office, you walked across the jaywalk. So it's called the jaywalk. So if you get the pun and the English nuance here, we asked our students to name that space. We gave them many options. They could call it a plaza, they could call it a commons, they could call it a quad, or they could give it a new name that they wanted to give it. And we had a vote for 3 days. And the students gave it the name on the first day of the jaywalk. And that name won the most votes. So that's the jaywalk. This is John Jay, this is the Moot Court. So I welcome you. Enough of the commercial announcement, just so you know who we are. So the very good fortune that we have tonight is to also celebrate our longstanding partnership with CMEA, which is the sort of think tank of the Ministry for Citizen Protection and Human Dignity in Greece. And CMEA has, over the years that we've been watching them and working with them, established itself as a real powerhouse in Greece and in the region and indeed in the European Union for doing careful work, careful thinking, careful scholarship on issues of security and human rights. And we're privileged to call them our partner. Tonight's discussion is part of a longer series of discussions that we've had here at John Jay over issues facing the Balkan region. And this is a good opportunity for me to thank our colleagues from the Stavros Niarchos Foundation who have made this work possible. They've allowed us to bring experts from the Balkan region and from Italy and from Spain to John Jay to talk about critical issues facing the region. Proving again the old adage, if you bring people outside of their comfort zone and outside of the place where they're always about to go back to work and bring them to a new place, and a neutral place, the mind expands. And you can think thoughts that you might not have thought otherwise. We're delighted that the Niarchos Foundation representatives are here, and I recognize Vasily Tamis and Agero Zikles for their support, and we say thank you to all of their colleagues in Athens as well, who are also good friends. And we want to acknowledge and celebrate another partnership that's evolving with the Office of the Consul General here in New York, the Consul General representing Greece, and represent Georgios Iliopoulos, there we go. That's better that time. Iliopoulos, right? Someone said, yes, thank you for that. I'm working on it. Who is now a frequent guest here at John Jay. And of course, our friends from Kamea, who you'll hear from in a second, who are our long-term partners. So in the life that I lead, I unfortunately can't stay here because I have one other obligation tonight that I have to attend to. So I'm going to unfortunately leave and not be able to participate and learn from your panel discussion. But let me first just introduce our Consul General, who will say a few words of welcome. I am polite enough to be here as long as the Consul General is speaking, and then I'll have to leave. And then you'll introduce the panel and invite them up. Is that the way we're doing this? You're introducing... And who does he introduce? And then someone else introduces someone else. Right? But we'll figure this out. Right? So please join me in welcoming to the podium Georgios Iliopoulos, the Consul General of Greece.
This is called burden sharing. I'll introduce Professor Andreopoulos, and he will take the lead. President Travis, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to start my brief remarks by thanking John Jay College, the President, and Professor Andreopoulos for kindly hosting this event. This is the second event we co-organize with John Jay College, the first being the lecture last year by Minister Nikos Dendias on the rule of law. And I must say that the cooperation with this college has always been very easy and problem-free. As most of you already know, John Jay College is organizing cooperation with KEMEA, the Center for Security Studies in the Ministry of Public Order. In June, it's a biennial international conference in Athens on promoting the rule of law in an era of change. And we all wish them the best of luck. I'm sure it will be a huge success. Migration is a global issue. Greece, like many other southern European countries, Italy, Spain, and of course not to forget Malta, have experienced enormous pressure from uncontrolled migration flows over the past two decades. At first from countries from the former Eastern Bloc, then from countries further away. Today, besides the motivation for a better life, the problem becomes more acute because of the latest developments in Africa, the Middle East, including Syria, but also in Asia, countries like Afghanistan or Pakistan, or many other countries. The current EU framework for dealing with this issue punishes the member states at the southern external borders. I know that I'm stating the obvious when I say that illegal immigration threatens not only social cohesion in the countries of southern Europe, but also the prospect of growth and prosperity. This problem cannot be considered a Greek problem, an Italian, a Maltese, French, or Spanish. Greece has made enormous efforts to cope with this influx in the midst of a very serious financial crisis. It has created a coherent national strategy for management of its external borders, but even so, its national asylum and migration systems are under unprecedented pressure. And although the progress is undeniable, no one can claim success in dealing with a problem that is related to human suffering and struggle for a better life. Failure is unfortunately part of the job, but improvement is all we can ask for. To give you only an indication, an example, since 2002, more than 1 million illegal immigrants have been arrested by the Greek authorities. And this number refers only to those that have been arrested. Unfortunately, even within the European Union, there are countries, not only in the north, that because of their geographic location alone, feel immune to this very European problem. Not only they seem somehow to believe that their societies are entitled to a sort of buffer zone, but they also fail to extend their solidarity to those member states that find themselves overburdened. On the other hand, there are also countries that facilitate this modern slave trade because they refuse to assume any responsibility towards tackling the problem. And in some cases, also because the whole industry has proven a very lucrative one. Dear friends, knowing that you are all eager to hear from our panelists, I would like to welcome you this evening and give without further ado the floor to Professor Andreopoulos, who will introduce us to the panelists. Thank you very much.
Good evening. I would like to welcome you all to this high-level panel discussion on a very critical issue area of migration. And before I say a few things about the panel and what are some of the issues that we have asked our panelists to address, I also like to acknowledge the contribution of the Consulate General of Greece in New York. I've been around this city for a long period of time, and I've had to work with many occupants of that office, and I have to say that we've never had a smoother cooperation since you've been here, so we really appreciate that, Mr. Iliopoulos. And also express our appreciation to the Stavros Niarchos Foundation, whose continued support of our programs, and in particular our partnership with the Center for Security Studies in Athens, has made possible a series of very productive outcomes, including, of course, the upcoming conference in Greece on the rule of law in an era of change, security, social justice, and inclusive governance. At a time when migratory movements call for effective management and international cooperation in a region with a continuing commitment to a fair and inclusive social orders, ensuring such effective as well as legitimate responses constitutes a key task of democratic and accountable governance. Clearly, the issue of migration involves many and complex issues, and it will not be possible to address all pertinent issues in this panel discussion. However, we have offered a series of focal issues and questions to our panelists around which we have asked them to address their remarks. And these include the following. What are some of the main issues affecting the prospects for effective international and regional cooperation in dealing with migratory flows? How do we address the tension between local, national needs and expectations and international and regional regulations and requirements? What are the challenges facing particularly vulnerable groups within migrant populations, especially women and children? What are the main obstacles to ensuring more inclusive social orders, especially in a time of austerity? And last but not least, what are the responsibilities of governments, civil society actors, and intergovernmental organizations in advancing integration policies? And I'm very pleased that we have a distinguished panel to address these issues. And I will not, of course, read their bios because you have all received a one pager that we have prepared with the resumes of all the speakers, just with their titles. Dimitrios Papadimitriou, who is the president of the Migration Policy Institute in Washington, D.C. Then he will be followed by Ambassador Ioannis Vrailas, deputy head of mission, European Union mission to the United Nations, and will be followed by Ambassador Inigo Lambertini, deputy head of mission of the permanent mission of Italy to the United Nations, and will conclude with Mr. Vasili Chamis, who is chief operating officer of the Stavros Niarchos Foundation. I also want to mention here that after this panel discussion is over, we are going to have a reception in the Justice Quad, which will also be accompanied by a photo exhibition of the important projects that the Stavros Niarchos Foundation is supporting in Greece in order to alleviate the effects of the economic crisis, so that I hope all of you will join us for the reception and the exhibition. So once again, thank you all for being with us this evening. Without further ado, I'll give the floor to Dr. Papadimitriou. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I'd like to thank the organizers. I will start with Mr. Iliopoulos, who talked me into coming to this event. And I'm glad that I was able to make it. It's a pleasure to be here. Needless to say, you will find my remarks a little different than the remarks of my colleagues. And you'll also find them a bit provocative. But before I start talking, I wanted to thank Mr. Michalis. I don't know you, but you know, at the president's office, I felt a sense of solidarity. You were the only person who did not have a tie. And feel free to take your jacket off, and then we're going to be in complete solidarity. Thankfully, several of you younger people don't have jackets on. I appreciate that. I think the organizers did a very good job in terms of the questions that they formed, which really go to the heart of the matter. If I were to sort of translate what it is that they have suggested, is that if we're going to make a difference, if we're going to have a different set of outcomes gradually over time with regard to illegal immigration, we're going to have to engage all possible levels of governance. In Eurospeak, and believe me, there is such thing as a Eurospeak, this is a multi-level governance kind of an issue. Indeed, at the international level, there are conversations. I said conversations, I didn't say, you know, outcomes, that talk about these issues all the time. As we speak, this week, in Stockholm, something called the Global Forum on Migration and Development is meeting for the seventh time in 7 years, and there are going to be about 150 countries and about 600 people who will be sitting around talking about these very issues. Some of these people in subgroups are going to be talking about migration and development. Some will be talking about managing migration to greater advantage for all who engage the process. Some of them will talk about the relationship between migration and development and how to have better development outcomes from international migration. What they will not be able to talk about is how do we manage migration better at the international level, because despite all these conversations, migration is still at best a sub-regional issue. In the case of the EU, of course, it's a regional issue. And in most instances, it is a bilateral issue in a small way and a unilateral sovereignty issue in over 90-95% of the times when it comes to major, or for that matter, mid-sized receiving societies. So effectively managing migration includes everything from the conversations at the global level to passing and implementing immigration laws. And just in case you're thinking that anybody does the job that they're supposed to do particularly well, let me assure you that nobody does their job particularly well. So don't have great expectations. Anytime that you go into meetings like this, if you would like to hear us to who is doing it better than anybody else. Another of the questions suggests that perhaps a regional approach, a la the EU, might be a better way to go about that system, managing this system. But people tend to forget, and first and foremost, our European friends tend to forget, is the uniqueness of the European Union. How many times have you or I or others heard about, you know, somehow in North America coming up with an EU system, forgetting the reasons for which the EU organized itself the way that it did about 60 plus years ago, 1951, the history that led to it, the evolution of the sets of institutions that it has created, and the uniqueness of how each member state relates to Brussels and vice versa. So the European Union is an interesting thing to be studying with regard to managing migration, but it is not a solution that is likely to be in any way adapted in other parts of the world, because in comparative thinking and public policy, context is king. I didn't say that context matters. I say that context is king. So today, we're going to talk a little bit about what is going on in that part of the world. Just like the Consul General said, the southern parts of Europe have come under, let's say, organized pressure. If you ask an average person in the street, in many places around Europe, what you're likely to hear is the kinds of things that you're also likely to hear in this country. Namely, these poor people sacrificing whatever it is that they need to sacrifice, spending their fortune, however small that fortune is, taking all the chances, because the system is so perverse, where all the chances are being taken by the individuals, the cargo, while all of the benefits and virtually nothing negative ever happens to the people who move people. And people forget that this is organized. People forget that syndicates are making an enormous amount of money out of this organized movement. People forget that once a country comes under systematic attack, as Greece did in the, let's say, about 3 years until about a year or so ago, and Italy, and particularly the southern part of Italy, has come under the past year, and so has Spain, that just about everything that you talk about in nice salons or in courses at fine universities is not all that terribly relevant. Because when you come under attack, you basically have your public clamoring for taking measures that in more regular circumstances you wouldn't be taking. The challenges that many of these countries face when they do come under systematic pressure by smugglers and their cargo are essentially what you would imagine. More controls, spending much more money to try to manage the flow after people have come in, and simultaneously coming under attack, and here the proper word is hypocrisy, coming under attack by their brethren in other parts of the EU, both for not protecting the EU's borders and for not treating the people who make it in well enough. And I assure you, I may be Greek in name. I've written, you know, a ridiculous number of books, articles, etc., etc., and I don't think that I've ever written a thing on Greece. So this is not about trying to defend the Greek presidency or Greece itself. This is about trying to understand the predicament that governments are under when they come under systematic pressure. The same predicament, as a matter of fact, that Eastern European countries were under about 20 years ago, 22 years ago, when Germany used to be a main route into the rest of Europe. But Germany is a big country. It is a very well-organized country. It has robust institutions. It has an enormous amount of human capital, and it can spend a very large number of funds in order to resolve issues. And let me tell you how Germany did it 22 years ago. After a four-year period, in which asylum seekers doubled every year, the same way that happens in so many different countries, 89, 90, 91, 92, from 50 to 102, 102 to 250, from 250 to 450, Germany changed its constitution to make certain that people would not think that they can get a buy simply by making it into Germany. In addition, Germany was the protagonist in creating something that is called the Dublin Convention. Mm-hmm. It is now in its fourth iteration. It basically forces the countries from within the European Union that are the entry points into the European Union, through which asylum seekers go and find themselves in the country of their preference, because it's not just that the flows are organized, they're also organized in order to get to a place that the asylum seeker wants. You know, last time I looked at asylum, you know, and people who are fleeing for their lives, they didn't choose where they wanted to go because, presumably, the only thing that they wanted was to be saved. So Germany was able to create a set of systems that gradually reduced dramatically the number of asylum seekers that he got. And 20 years later, with a whole bunch of buffer states, which are the accession 8, in other words, the member states that joined the European Union in 2004 and the two states that joined the European Union in 2007, and with special agreements with countries that are outside of the European Union, but at the borders of the European Union, Northern Europe is safe, but not because, and here is one of the things that we need to be particularly careful about. Despite the fact that Southern Europe still takes very large numbers of unauthorized immigrants, masquerading as refugees, and I'll explain that sentence, the Central European countries, including Germany and France and others, actually also have more than their share of refugees. These are people who come in through airports, present themselves, and ask for asylum. And those numbers are also very large. So the picture is a bit more muddied than you would think. So what do we do about all this? I think just like, you know, the invitation says, or the topics that Professor Andreopoulos put on the table say, you have to have greater regional cooperation. But what's the region? Who do you cooperate with? And what are the terms of this cooperation in any set of negotiations? For negotiations to be successful, one of the parties has to give something that's of value to him or her in order to get in return something that's of greater value. What does the EU give to the region when it negotiates with them on these issues? Next to nothing. And is the EU, the Commission, organized enough to be able to use all of the levers that it has available in order to be able to be a real successful negotiator? I'll tell you what the EU does not have. It does not have work visas. work visas belong to the member states. It can offer greater openings in terms of travel to the EU, and that is significant to a certain degree, but it's not significant enough to change anyone's mind. And the only other thing that the EU has that's of substance is development aid. But development aid, the people who do development aid do not want to tie the aid to behavior of both sending countries and transit countries on a topic that most high politics types consider not significant enough. As a result, most of the agreements that take place within the region are not really observed. So what we have is essentially a situation that is not managed, and under the current set of circumstances cannot be managed well enough on the part of the European Union and its institutions. So these folks come in. Sometimes, you know, a few thousand at a time, sometimes one at a time through airplanes. What does a state do? Well, it has to try to figure out who is who, because identity is a game that everybody who is trying to enter and stay in the country is playing. They throw away their identity documents, they throw away their passports, so it's next to impossible to find with any kind of certitude as to who these people belong to, what country they come from. And very quickly, a country has to determine who has a legitimate asylum claim. Let me give you the data, you know, because Greece has had one of the lowest asylum recognition rates in the world, less than 1%, but now it's going up under pressure by the other governments in the EU. But even other countries that are much more generous with regard to asylum essentially find only 5 to 7 to 8% of all of the people who come in a country illegally and say we're asylum seekers as deserving of asylum protection. So you have about 93%, let's say, left. From this 93%, countries in the European Union and the United States, because we're all, you know, progressive countries, trying to play not only with the rule of law, but also trying to give the benefit of the doubt to some of the people who come as part of these flows. There's a certain proportion that we like to protect for additional reasons that are not part of an international agreement that we have called the Convention, the Refugee Convention of 1951. That's another what? 10%. 15%, 20%. You still have about 73% left. From this 73%, everybody's fairly certain that they are not refugees, they don't have a legitimate claim to asylum, and they should be returned. But return, of course, takes time, is very expensive. And the biggest problem, how can you return people to countries when the ambassadors of this country say to you, she's not mine, can you prove to me? Can you prove to me that she is this or he is that? So from this remaining 70%, another 20, 30, 40% you cannot send back. And the 30% that's the remainder, you send back, but it costs an awful lot of money, and it takes a long time before you can actually send them back. So the moral of all this, and I'll stop here, is the system that, in a sense, exists de facto in Europe, and perhaps a system toward which we are moving in the United States, is as follows. Don't you dare come in. If you come in, if you try to come in, we'll stop you. On the way to trying to come in, your kids and yourself may be raped, will certainly be abused. Whatever money you have, we'll take it from you. After you make it in, you will be our indentured servants in order to pay off the rest of your debt. And in the last step, whether it's the southern border of the United States or the Mediterranean, a whole bunch of you will die. That, ladies and gentlemen, is the perfect definition of what it means to have a system that lives in a perverse world. But what is even more perverse than that? You basically look at them and you wink, wink, but if you make it in, you're pretty much safe. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Papadimitriou. Ambassador Vraile.
Well, thank you very much. It's an honor to follow up on an authority on the matter like Professor Papadimitriou, and I'd like to thank my good friend, the Consul General, George Iliopoulos, a new professor, for giving me this this opportunity. And I'm also sorry that I have jinxed your problem-free cooperation between the two, because one of the panelists who I had introduced could seemingly lost his way. So sorry about that.
They stop him at the border, probably.
Probably, right. He's Mexican.
So. Yeah, that's why I said it. That's why I said it.
Anyway. I didn't find the remarks by Professor Papadimitriou very provocative until the end. I hope you didn't mean that it is the official EU policy to sort of treat the people that way. I will admit that I'm not an expert on the matter. I'm your traditional jack of all trades, and so I asked my colleagues in Brussels if they could not send me some material that I could use for this presentation, and this is more or less what I got, which I tried to sum up. I was looking for a good definition of what the EU tries to do. What's the definition of the EU migration policy? And the best I could come up with was we're trying to promote two things: a well-managed, and I'll get back to that, a well-managed migration policy in support of our wider comprehensive political, economic, and social objectives. And also to promote the concept of an open and secure Europe while upholding the highest standards of human rights. So, a bit to the end, to the other extreme of what we were hearing a little earlier. And of course, I understand also that what, you know, the picture that you also have in mind is that of immigrants cramped in unseaworthy boats, trying to make a perilous trip to reach Europe, and very often paying the ultimate price for it. Why is a well-managed migration policy important? A well-managed migration policy is one that raises revenue, that supports businesses, that creates jobs, that allows for the transfer of skills, of technology, of ideas, that promotes investments, that promotes trades. One that is good for the originating country, for the recipient country, for the immigrant, and for his or her family. Everybody, it's a win-win situation in the ideal world. In the non-ideal world, where you have a poorly managed migration policy, and very much along the lines that we heard earlier, there you have usually people who leave their countries of origin out of despair, who fall prey to illegal traffickers and organized crime. If they do make it to the recipient country, again, they're faced with all sorts of difficulties. They may be seen themselves as a source of social tension and instability. And at the end of the day, instead of acting as a bridge between the originating and the recipient country, they become even a source of tension at the international level. Now, what are we trying to do to have a well-managed migration policy? I'll mention the areas just that you have an idea of how wide the issue is and how many efforts need to be made on so many different fronts. Schengen, I think the importance cannot be overstated as a space which allows both for mobility in between its members and for developing the concept of external border. We also have, again, in strengthening this concept of common border, the European Agency for the Management of Operational Cooperation at the external borders of the member states of the European Union. It took me about 20 minutes to memorize this. It's Frontex, basically, which I think you know is a term that which you're more familiar with, and where they, again, for instance, the external border surveillance system and the visa information system, which links the consulates of the members of Schengen around the world, but also all the various border crossing points at the external borders. You need to have a common European asylum system, and Dublin, of course, is part of it, with its faults and weaknesses, which were rightly mentioned. Managing the regular migration, there's directives which deal with the EU blue card, that's for highly qualified workers. There's the single permit directive. There's the long-term residence directive, which allows for people who have been staying in EU countries to then be able to stay a little without more difficulties. Now, during the Greek presidency, there has also been some good progress on seasonal workers and on what is referred to as intra-corporal transfers, meaning that companies who have offices around the world and want to send some of their people in a European country can do so. In tackling irregular migration, you have the EU anti-trafficking coordinator of the Commission, and there's of course the issue of returns. There's a return directive which sets the standards and the procedures for the members on how to deal with this. There's a financing, an important financing aspect. There's the European External Borders Fund, which helps countries deal with the various aspects. And there's also a return fund. And then there's the relations with the outside world. The European Union participates in all the various discussions on the international level. I agree that they do not produce much, but we are a main actor. We promote a dialogue with third countries. The global approach to migration is seen as a complementary tool to the common foreign and security policy and to our development cooperation policy. And it's something that we promote in our relations with third countries all the time. We invest a lot in trying to strengthen political and economic stability in those countries, including in our immediate neighborhood, both southern and eastern. Indirectly, I would argue, in response to what the professor said, that all our efforts that we do on the humanitarian front, we're the largest humanitarian donor. We are the largest provider of development assistance. We always advocate democratization and respect of human rights in the third countries, and also our crisis management operations and missions. All that helps in a way a well-managed migration in the sense that the less instability you have around the world, the less people will want to leave under the conditions that we know. Of course, all this is in the ideal world. What are the challenges? One main challenge, as I said, is in everything that I pointed out. There's so many areas, there's so many fronts that you need to focus on. If one were in charge of the issue, he or she wouldn't really know where to begin. There's an institutional problem. You all know that the members of Schengen are not all members of the European Union, and vice versa, not all EU member states are members of Schengen. So that creates sometimes practical difficulties. For instance, these days I was reading that the United Kingdom, which is not a member of Schengen, would like to participate fully in Frontex, but European Court has said that no, you can't, since you basically cannot have your cake and eat it, is the message. And there's of course a dichotomy between, on the one hand, the need to promote effectiveness and efficiency, avoid duplication in today's world and with more limited resources, and on the other hand, countries feel still that these issues of visas, external borders, are very much linked to their sovereignty, and so that's another area of difficulty. But the main problem is the numbers. The numbers have reached such a magnitude that it's extremely difficult now to deal with the issue in a proper manner. For instance, we had 175 million immigrants around the world in 2001. We're now at 232 million. The figures are of 2012. When it comes to requests for asylum, they fluctuate a little. We were at 435,000 in 2000. We went down to 200,000 in 2006. Last year, we were at 336,000. This year, we will be reaching record levels. And every year, about 500,000 illegal immigrants are apprehended in the European countries. So that, by itself, creates a major difficulty. Second problem is those numbers will not go down anytime soon. We live in a globalized, interconnected world. A lot of people would like to come to Europe, in any case, aiming for a better life. But you've got crisis and conflicts, as George said, in Syria, in Afghanistan, in Pakistan. You've got humanitarian catastrophes. A couple of years ago, in the Horn of Africa, there was a famine. You also have environmental degradation in the Sahel region. So a lot of people are looking for a way out because they simply cannot find a way to live.
Go ahead.
2 minutes.
Got you. I was told to do that.
Absolutely. No. It's revenge. Three, the numbers are not evenly distributed among the member states, and that creates the problems of solidarity that both George and Professor Papadimitriou mentioned, and which I'm sure my Italian colleague will refer to as well. And finally, other numbers that went up were that of the deficit and of unemployment in many European countries. And so in times of austerity, as was said, it is more difficult to confront the problem. Societies are vulnerable, and of course then they're prone to xenophobia and to those who try to promote anti-immigration laws. One final word, what do we need to do? We need to continue our efforts. You can never be satisfied with the situation that we all know. And I think we all have a duty as governments, civil society, academia, journalists, to try and fend off some of the stereotypes that surround immigration. Immigrants cannot be always a scapegoat for everything. They cannot serve our purpose when the going is good, and they can do, they provide cheap labor for this kind of jobs that we don't want to do, and they're suddenly the source of all evil when the going gets a little tougher. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Ambassador Vrala, to disabuse you of the notion that there are too many Greeks on this panel. Ambassador Lambertini. Okay.
Well, maybe I can name myself Lambertinopoulos. So
Lambertinopoulos.
thank you for the John Jay. Thank you to the professor. Thank you to the Consul General. I think you, with all the audience, look, the Greek presence in the audience. I would like to start thinking to a meeting on which I participated 2 weeks ago, more or less. It was a meeting in the permanent mission of Switzerland to the United Nations with the special representative of the Secretary General Ban Ki-moon on migration. Because one of the discussions that is ongoing in the United Nations is migration will be one of the problem and goal of post-2015 agenda. But I don't want to elaborate on this. But just to say to you something that I'm during the meeting. It was a meeting during a luncheon meeting at the Switzerland mission, and the Switzerland ambassador served us pasta. That, of course, as Italian, I was very happy to have this pasta. But this also bring me the attention to the fact that if you actually here in New York, you can eat an excellent pasta. And I can say Buenos Aires, São Paulo, Toronto, Athens, Frankfurt, and over and over. It's because we have years and years of Italian migration in the world. So migration as such is in our blood. The difference that, coming back to the meeting, after the presentation ended and the Q&A session was open, there were 6 countries who raised their flag to speak. Egypt, Morocco, Turkey, Greece, Italy, and Malta. And this is because, actually, why we are also here today, because migration is a worldwide phenomenon, as the professor Papademetriou explained us. I received a report from our ambassador accredited to Capo Verde that the government of Capo Verde just appointed the minister for illegal migration from Africa, because Capo Verde is a relatively successful history in Africa. And so you have migrants from Western Africa that go to Capo Verde. But the magnitude of the problem, and if I can put this way, the tragedy that is happening in the Mediterranean, maybe it's no precedent at all. This meeting came very suddenly timely because, for instance, 2 days ago, there was another incident close to the Libyan and Italian part of the Mediterranean. There are estimated 400 deaths in this incident, a lot of kids. Our Prime Minister Renzi, of course, we are in the middle of an electoral campaign, but yesterday said it looks that Europe is keen to save banks, but it's not keen to save kids. Because this is the emotional situation that the last years, the migration of the last year, bring to my country. We have known decades of migration. We started with the Balkans as the Greece, as the other country. But was a different type of migration, was basically a migration of people that decided to went to Italy or Greece or other countries to stay in that country. The great majority of them stayed, and most of them have a successful history. Some of them is criminal histories, but at least was a more normal or more usual migration, as we, as Italian, we knew in the past. The current situation is different in the Mediterranean. First, because the people who arrived in Italy, in Greece, Malta, Spain, in the great majority, they do not want to stay in our countries, but they want to move northern. And this brings the European dimension of the problem. Second, the great majority of them arrived in our countries throughout criminal organization. Third, this criminal aspect of immigration increased a lot in the last 2-3 years because the so-called Arab Spring actually destroyed this, some states, and I'm referring as Italian particularly to Libya. Of course, Gaddafi was not a right man, but if I can put in a very unofficial way, it was our not right man. We had agreement with him, we paid him, but there was someone on that was possible. I mean, if you use the phone, someone on the other fine or the other part of the Italy of the sea respond to the telephone. Now in Libya, you have no one but thousands of organizations that brought people to the north. We have another similar, even worse incident close to Lampedusa 1 year and a half ago, where there were hundreds of people who died. And the emotional pushing of this was so hard that we created, thanks also to the European Union, this organization, this program that's called Mare Nostrum. It's a Latin name of the Mediterranean when it was the Roman Empire, and maybe was more quiet when we were in the end of all the Mediterranean. That basically, what was it, Mare Nostrum? We moved southern our boat. Basically, now we rescue people 40, 50 miles north from the Libyan shoulder. But this situation created another complication. It improved the criminal and illegal migration, because now the trafficked people knows that after 40 miles, there are the Italians there. So the quality, if I can put it this way, of the ships are so degraded that increases the possibility of accident. What's happened 2 days ago was the fifth very wrecked ship that moved in 2 hours from a little part of Libya close to Benghazi. This is basically the dimension that we are trying to face currently in the Mediterranean. And as Johannes said, the situation, it will not know in the future any amelioration. According to the figures of our services, so put in with some, I mean, there are around 800,000, 1,200,000 people in the desert approaching to the trafficking people of Libya. There are people that have nothing to lose. The people who arrived in Lampedusa or in Greece, it's already, if I can put in this very cynical way, it's already the product of a selection. There are a lot, they have already lost their lives in the desert, or lost their lives on the coast of the Libya, or lost their lives in some part of Egypt. And in this picture now, you have to add the what 2 years ago was incredible to imagine, illegal migration from Syria. The big difference that, at least in Italy, we see in these two different migrations, that coming from the African part, in the great majority are young male alone people, coming from, and not very skilled. Some of them have already did this trip 2, 3, 4 times. They try to arrange the future. People who arrived in from Syria, and they arrived in places where until 2 years ago the migration phenomenon was unknown. You know, all the northern part of the Sicily, the Calabria, the part close to Puglia, are qualified people, a lot of physicians, engineers, professors, family, women, kids. They will never return back. And they want to go, in the 90% of the cases, to Sweden, Germany, Denmark, Finland. I have no solution to put here in discussion, but I just want to underline that this is a pivotal problem for my country as the other country of the Mediterranean. It's a problem that complicated a lot, also our internal life. If I can put another not to do dimension, as Ioannis said previously, and this is really, we should think because it's possible, to deal in a very clear manner with this situation, one, maybe the most important thing that we have not to do is to transform the migration in political issues for election in the country. This is what we did in 4 years. The party of the Lega Nord basically exploited the fear of the Italian of losing something. But we are not alone doing this in the world, not only in Europe. It's very easy to exploit this. The Europe could help us to explain the real dimension of the issues, but clear we need a more coordinated effort. I thank you, and I'm glad that I don't have the 2 minutes rule.
Yes, just made it. Thank you. Thank you, Ambassador Lambertini. Mr. Tammy.
Dr. Andreopoulos, John Jay College, dear ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. I'm in this very fortunate position to close a parenthesis here with a ray of hope, a ray of future, a ray of some hopefully a bit positive tone in this kind of desperate situation that we're all facing. I represent the Stavros Niarchos Foundation, a foundation that it has 3 offices around the world, some 55 people. It's the brainchild of Stavros Niarchos, the shipping tycoon as known by a lot, who felt that he should really share some of his fortune with the less fortunate. We have a very broad agenda, a very wide spectrum. We are in arts and culture, education, social welfare, health and medicine. And the man who succeeded in focusing in many areas, he also deliberately left the space open for us to interpret his wishes after his death in 1996. The panelists before me describe with eloquence, clarity, and precision all the elements and the difficulties in relation to this very thorny problem that exists. I have nothing much to add really on the technicalities of the issue. You know very well the economic maladies that are facing the region, the pathologies of the individual European Union economies, but if the theory of relativity prevails, then you will see that it is, after all, better for these poor people to cross, to take their lives in their hands and cross the oceans to come to Europe. Still today, the destination of choice for these people is Europe. In the foreseeable future, most likely will continue to be the same. There's no doubt about it. Our own foundation's objectives in life is to address this wide spectrum of needs, and we do this with a very deliberate and organized fashion. We support other philanthropic organizations that have an interest in helping mankind around the world. We have 2 major focal areas in our decision-making process. First of all, we see if this other nonprofit organization that we support have a clear mission and add value to the society. And secondly, if their leaderships, their management in place is committed, devoted, motivated, unconditionally supporting the cause that they came to existence. Having that in mind, we are going back and back test after we provide the support, and we make sure that they commit it and they deliver what they promise, deliver satisfactory results, viable solutions, not just good intention or wishful thinking. In this wide area or spectrum of our activities, we have up to now provided in those many philanthropic causes over $1.5 billion since our existence in 1996. In some 2,000 and 500 grants distributed to some 110 countries. In the particular area of migration, we supported in Greece five quick examples that I will give you. The Greek Consul for Refugees, which is a 25-year-old organization aiming to improve access to free legal aid and social counseling for asylum seekers arriving in Greece. This program involves the provision of legal aid, social counseling at reception and detention centers outside Athens, and especially at entry and exit points, placing emphasis on the difficult area of Evros River on the border of Turkey. This is the largest non-governmental organization in Greece, exclusively dedicated to addressing refugee issues. We support an organization named Praxis. This is a non-for-profit which offers a wide range of general, dental, gynecological health services for immigrants and underserved populations, as well as medications on both Athens and Thessaloniki, the two biggest cities in Greece. The organization continues the work of the Greek arm of Médecins Sans Frontières, which has been continue supporting in many other aspects the global community. This program also includes street work for immediate medical support and advice to these sensitive communities, including the well-known Roma populations in Greece. We also assisted the Doctors Without Borders programs. Here we aim to provide much needed medical and psychological support to migrants and the four main detention centers of Greece, including the exit points of Igoumenitsa and Patras. Doctors Without Borders in Greece was founded in 1990, and since then has attracted more than 450 workers, most of them doctors, administrative personnel, and logisticians, providing services to some 40 countries around the world. We also provided financial support to the Greek Forum of Immigrants. This program purpose is the social integration of second-generation immigrants, focusing in the particularly vulnerable age of 16 to 25 years of age. Furthermore, the program is offering Greek citizenship to second-generation immigrants and the legal support to achieve that. We have extended grants to the Greek Consul for Refugees, which operates a non-stop refugee reception service center where refugees have access to informational material, legal counseling, and other general services. These services focus on simple legal counseling, advice on accommodations, medical care, or other social issues, as well as the prevention of material assistance such as relief packages. Finally, the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, he was a recipient of our own support. This organization needs no introduction. We support an educational program to promote tolerance, respect, peace, democratic discourse, and the prevention of racial prejudice. The program is addressed to young generations, educators, parents, as well as general public, and aims to intervene in three ways: training teachers and educators, raising student awareness with educational programs, and finally, engaging parents' associations as well as surrounding communities. The plan is carried out through the use of specialized workshops and seminars, focused not only in Athens and Thessaloniki, the two major centers, but also Rethymno and Mytilene, key areas where immigration and racism phenomena are observed. The Office of the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees has been operating in Greece since March of 1952. These are a few examples of our grants offering direct support to this particularly vulnerable population. I shall conclude my presentation by saying that in all the 2,500 grants that we're extending, we're putting as a catalyst, as a demand, as an objective, as an absolutely essential ingredient, that the management of these entities, of these philanthropic organizations, provide each grantee unconditioned support irrespective of their race, age, gender, religion, social status, ethnic origin, or sexual preferences. Close by saying we still have faith in the mankind, we still have faith, and we still hope. Thank you.
a brief question so that we can get a chance to have as many people as possible participate in this discussion. Thank you. So, okay. Yes. We have a...
Thank you.
Mike, yeah.
I think I can be heard.
Okay.
My name is Panos Adamopoulos, and I came here to the States on a student visa, an immigrant myself. The question is to the whole panel, if I don't know if anyone can answer that, but the European Commission, this moment, faces a challenge. And as it relates to Greece, these challenges, I believe that the policy design should take into account all the weaknesses that the Greek government is facing today because of the financial crisis, to attend to a problem that has been overwhelming for Greece, and I'm talking about Greece because I can relate to that much more. Italy is the same, Spain, Portugal. And these policy designs should take that particular challenge into account, because the social ramifications on a social policy for that particular country are immense. And I want to ask the panel whether or not the European Commission is taking these policies into account.
Thank you.
I just can comment. The size of the problem, the paramount of a problem, it's so big that even a Greek government in the fully economic stable situation, or an Italian government in the full, et cetera, they can't have any sort of solution alone. That means that the European Commission has to intervene in a very strong way, in a more effective way than what's happened today. The problem is that we are moving in a period of change at the European institutions, new election, new European Commission, and new... So the urgence is there, but not the political agenda.
If I may just complement, it is not just the European Commission. The decisions are taken by the member states, and this is where we have the difficulty, because as was said, there's a divergence of interests, which is a fake one. I would not agree that the countries of Northern Europe or the core of Europe are immune to the problem, because at the end of the day, if the waves of refugees and immigrants and others keep showing up, they will be swarmed just like the southern Mediterranean. So it's really a case of showing solidarity and finding a collective answer to a problem that affects everyone. And it's also fair to say that the countries of southern Europe are not looking for, are not asking for handouts, just give us money. They are asking for a comprehensive policy that will take care, to the extent possible, again, taking into account the magnitude of the problem, of the various issues.
You know, I am trying to actually, when I heard you talking, I said, we need to be a little more positive. He's right. Mm-hmm. But Mr. Adamopoulos asked the question that you cannot spin in a positive direction, however hard you try. So should the European Commission cut some slack to the Greeks because of these surrounding circumstances that they have, whether it's the financial crisis or, for that matter, these organized flows trying to come through Europe and the islands in order to get to Greece. And here what you have is clashes of priorities and principles. The European Union is also a space where the rule of law has to be observed. And it's not just European law,
at all laws. And unlike us, the Europeans observe the European Convention on Human Rights, which requires member states to behave in a certain way. The behavior, the behavior of places in the south of Europe with regard to these unregulated flows essentially violate the rule of law. More importantly, however, they violate the sense of values that the European Union stands for. It is extremely important. So the European Union, in a sense, just like so many member states, at the same time insist that the southern Europeans protect Europe's borders, and at the same time insist that they treat people properly according to the rule of law, European law, international law, and, of course, in accordance with the values of the Union. Now, you see, I said something positive, I think. Now, let me say something that is a bit of the opposite of positive. Just like the deputy permanent rep, you know, sorry, I am going to deputy head of mission, like Ioannis said. It is not Brussels only that does that. An awful lot of member states, I'm not going to mention any names because I'm not quite sure whether this has been taped or broadcast.
It is.
It is both?
Yeah.
Okay, so, you would think, you know, the good citizens of Northern Europe, as well as some of the not so good, I'm sorry, good member states of Northern Europe, and then some member states in the middle of Europe that are, you know, sort of a little more confused about it, have really pressured the Commission and sometimes very directly Greece and other member states to actually protect the borders better. And there is a European Court of Justice decision of about 2.5 years that has enraged its very good citizens of Europe. Namely, the court ruled that when people who enter Greece or Italy or whatever else, Spain, because Spain now is under the microscope, in addition to Italy, when they enter these places, and according to the rules of the Common European Asylum System and Dublin 14, I'm sure there are no 14, but I just want to exaggerate this, there is the requirement that these countries can send these people back to the country through which they enter the European Union for their asylum claims to be adjudicated there. But the court said, because the conditions in Greece in this particular case were so bad, these places could not send asylum seekers back to Greece, which added to their burden, the burden of the people where the asylum seekers had all along wanted to go. We have to understand that this is, you know, I said perverse, but I think when I heard some of my colleagues, you know, the word almost became obscene rather than perverse. It's systematic. I think it is extremely important for the Niarchos folks and other foundations to be supporting organizations that focus on offering services to these folks. But it is also equally important to know that these are not people who, out of some absolutely having no other opportunities or anything like that, decided to take any chances in order to make it to Europe. These are people with means. These are people who really wanted to improve their opportunities, opportunities for them and their families, which at a theoretical level, it is important. Don't we all want this for our families? But on another level, we shouldn't confuse these people with refugees. We apply this broad term as of refugees, which is a highly, highly specialized meaning under the Convention of 1951 of the UNHCR. So I think that some smart thinking, some hard heads, and some policies that are implemented with thoughtfulness but also strength are needed in order to send a different message to the people who move people and indirectly to the people who want to put themselves in the hands of horrible people in order to get to Europe. This is called signaling. If you don't signal that even if you make it in, we're going to send you back, more people will come. You heard the data. More people will come. Every time that we embrace and we say this is horrible, you can be guaranteed more people will come. I'll give you an example that happens in Europe, although in Europe people haven't really focused on it, but it's happening in the United States and the US is focusing on it. Minors. We call them in the business unaccompanied minors. That means children, you know, under 17, 17 or under, sometimes as young as 6 and 8 and 10 years old, sometimes brothers and sisters, that are put into this particular, you know, sort of vortex by their families, or who lose their families in the process. Let me give you some numbers. The number of unaccompanied minors for this year in the United States will probably exceed 60,000 minors. Would you like to know what it was 3 years ago? About 4,000 minors. So what do you think happened? It is the behavior at the other end that conveys the message that if you do that because we are going to protect minors, all civilized societies will protect minors. They're the ones that we care most about. Then what you have is indeed everybody sending their children either to reunify with their families who may be here or to become, in a sense, the entry point and the anchor around which you can build more of the family migration system. The system is corrupt by any definition of the word corruption. Now, I can be more positive. What can we do about it? Because there are things that can be done. One of the best ways to break two of the most horrible things that are going on in the international movement of people that we have been discussing today, two things. The first one is, as soon as people make it into Europe, you move them into a processing center. This way they don't go where it is that you want them, that they want to go. At that processing center, their claims are adjudicated by the nicest, best adjudicators from throughout Europe, under the supervision of the UNHCR. But every time that someone comes to Europe, is sent to a processing center. What would that do in addition to signaling? It would break, you know, something that is true only in rhetoric. It's called solidarity, European solidarity. Senior people in the commission, commissioners and, you know, above will basically tell you that the last thing that Europe is doing on immigration and refugee and asylum systems is promote or exhibit solidarity. In fact, one of them said to me, just 5 or 6 years, you know, essentially with Lampedusa incidents in last October, Europe is all about the opposite of solidarity. So, how do you really move forward in a direction of real solidarity? You send everybody to a processing center. If their asylum claim is legitimate, then you distribute them across the EU. That's the only circumstances under which member states of the European Union, from Sweden to Greece, from Germany to Spain, will agree to take even a single asylum seeker. Let me give you a number that should shock you. The whole of the European Union, 500 and whatever million people, the richest area in the world, including countries that are far richer than anything that we recognize here, resettles 3,500 1,000 refugees. Okay? This is the reality. Because when the Commissioner for Home Affairs, whose portfolio is all of these issues, goes hat in hand to the various member states' governments, the ministers that manage this issue, because many of these countries have a minister dedicated to immigration, she comes back with nothing, even from her native Sweden, because they say, I take all the ones that I want to take, who make it to Sweden. I'm not going to pay for the failures of Greece. I'm not going to pay for the failures of whatever. So unless you completely turn the problem on its head, you're not going to make any progress. More money you will spend, more people will die. Certainly the syndicates are going to get a hell of a lot richer. And we're going to have the same conversation 3 or 4 years from now.
Mr. Chami, you want to say anything? Okay, there are three hands here, I see. Yes, Mr.
Nicholas Bornos, two questions, please. I'm sorry, a lot of people may be very aware of what's going on. I am one of those who is not an expert, so my question is going to be very simplistic. The first question is there any system in the European Union that would provide actually financial support to the countries to implement the various policies? And number two, when you mentioned about sending those people back, would the country where they're coming from accept them? And I heard you saying before that many times these people who cross over have no papers. How do you know that the Pakistan is coming from Turkey? Would Turkey accept them back, for example, if you ever send them back to Pakistan?
Okay. You want to take the first part? Yeah.
Well, I mentioned two of the funds that have been created to deal with the situation. And I have the numbers here. The budget of External Borders Fund, if you look at the sums that have been allocated to Greece since 2007, they amount to 208 million euros. And it's interesting that it was 13 million and a half in 2007, about 44 million euros in 2013. And the budget of Return Fund, which I also mentioned, Greece has received since 2008 125 million euros. So one can argue that these are not, these are not peanuts, and B, that there is a recognition that you know, the sums have been going up, and therefore there's a recognition that Greece is facing a particular pressure when it comes to dealing with the problem. I don't know what the figures would be in the case of Italy, but again, this money will go down the drain, go down the black hole if you don't continue to pursue a comprehensive policy and with this kind of solidarity that was mentioned earlier.
Okay. Anybody else wants to say briefly something?
Very briefly, there's lots of money. There's much more money than that. Mm-hmm. Okay? I mean, it's exactly as Yanni said, you know, in terms of the amount that has been given to Greece. But DG Home has much more money than that for these purposes. The problem is very often with the ability of the country to actually be able to manage and absorb that money effectively. Okay? So, you know, if you talk to the commissioner or the director general that controls this money, the figure of close to $200 million is always on the table. But it can be absorbed only in much smaller amounts. On the issue that they won't take them back, of course they won't take them back. It's a system. They want something in return. And here is where you're going to have to be a bit of a bully and a good diplomat.
You can't be just a good Samaritan all the time. I'm sorry, okay, Mr. Ambassador, this must not be Afghans. This must not be, I'm not picking on Afghanistan. Call it whatever, you know. These are not Greeks. Yeah, they speak that, they look that, they have all of the characteristics, they don't speak any of the other languages. Of course, as we all know, the variations, even if you speak the same language between two countries, to any guy, any person who is a linguist, of course, are completely evident. So it's not possible that you can say that somehow, you know, he's not whatever or she's not whatever. It's a game. And somebody has to try to manage that game better than we're managing at this time.
I think we have time for a couple of more.
In our experience, I don't know if it's a game, but it's quite hard to bring back the people. Professor Papademetriou stressed important issues that basically the 90% of the repatriation is on the shoulder of the Mediterranean countries because of the current European law. A lot of them, they have no documents at all, they have nothing at all, and they change nationality according to the situation. For instance, now, even if we know that there are very few Libyans that expatriated, when they are in the brink to be repatriated, they say that we are Libyans because you have no effective government in Tripoli, so nobody can confirm if they are Libyans. Or Palestinian, exactly. In the past, the situation worked a little bit better because we made bilateral agreement with a lot of these countries. And this is, maybe I cannot say this, but this agreement was made on money transfer. This was the only way in which we were able to have an enough workable situation. Now it's over.
Thank you. I have time for two more questions. Then we can continue the conversation during the reception. Yes. You are the Frontex.
I don't know if I'm the Frontex, but again, it all boils down to the member states taking collectively the same, agreeing on a common denominator. And so far, that doesn't seem to be the case. If you're asking of the prospects, I don't see it happening anytime very soon.
Okay. Anybody else?
A very quick EASO, the asylum, the European whatever, EASO in Malta is headed by a particularly able director general who is thoughtful and he has his heart in the right place. So heart and head are in the right place. And despite the fact that the office is only, I want to say, 3 years, I was there at its inception, so I bet it was 3 years ago in the summertime, probably around this time. They're still building. But what they're doing very well is having extraordinarily good modules, instruction modules, in which they train adjudicators from throughout Europe. This way, the objective of the EASO is to have the same outcome in an asylum application in Norway as you would in Greece, as you would in Portugal. And that is a good goal to aim for.
Thank you. Yes, last question.
My name is Aris Christodoulou. I appreciated the ambassador outlining the new infrastructure at the EU to address the migration problem. I also noted that the EU is frustrated, as are the particularly the southern tier countries, Greece and so on. When I went to the EC website the other day, I noticed that three countries, Denmark, the UK, and Ireland, have opted out of that the EU immigration policy because they felt that it did not fit their national problem. Of course, Greece can say the same thing and opt out, but of course it would lose the funding, and it hasn't done so. My question is, has there been anything as an experimental result that has come from this experience of the three countries, where they specifically wanted to get away from the E framework and put their own framework in that works better in some regards than the EU process?
It's difficult to say, because if you look at the geography, the comparison could have been made if geographically they were part of Southern Europe and they were facing the same pressures on their reception centers, on their asylum capability that the Southern European countries are facing. Because of their geography, and especially the United Kingdom and Ireland, I would have wanted to see them in case there was, God forbid, a huge crisis here in the United States, and then you had boats, trying to cross the Atlantic and showing up on their shores. But that is not happening. It's a lot easier for them to control. Now, having said that, I remind you that, as I mentioned, the United Kingdom would like to participate in progress because it sees that it is, as I said, not immune. There are issues related to counterterrorism, to cybercrime, to organized crime, and that can permeate the whole of Europe. But they do not feel, of course, the same pressure as
the other. The second wave of migration,
right?
And they
right.
Here.
Right. But who was it? Was it George who mentioned that? There's a buffer zone.
Or basically, we are looking for a wave of Vikings that decide to immigrate.
They
can
have their detention for 10 years if they are going illegally in the country. And their children, even if they are born in their detention camps, are not allowed to go to school.
That's good signaling.
The
signal. That's unmistakable signal. Any last minute comments? Of course, the discussion, as I say, will continue during the reception. Now, this brings us to the end of the form, at least the end of the formal session here. And I hope that you will join me in thanking Dr. Papadimitriou, Ambassador Vrailas, Ambassador Lambertini, and Mr. Chamis. I also, as I said at the beginning, my issues relating to migration will be addressed at our conference in Athens in June 2014. We are organizing with our dear friends and partners, the Center for Security Studies at the Ministry of Public Order and Citizen Protection. So those of you who are coming to Athens will be able to continue the conversation with us. Those of you who will not be able to come to Athens, I strongly suggest that you rethink your travel plans for your summer and that you try to make a stop and will definitely allow them in. You are not going to be stopped at the border. I would like, before we close, to thank, and at the risk of sounding Hillary Clinton-esque here, for an event like this, it takes more than a village to organize the event tonight. So there are many people and entities that I would like to acknowledge in closing, in addition, of course, to the Consulate General, our partners in Greece, KEMEA, and the Stavros Niarchos Foundation, the Office of the President, and Lisa and her team for all the work. And Lisa, I promise you, at least for a couple of days, we'll not have 10 phone calls a day back and forth, okay? At least for a couple of days, get a break. Also, Jane Rosengarten and her team at marketing and development for all the work, as well as our own staff at the Center for International Human Rights, Aferdita, Catherine, Marina, and Nico. Nico, you are playing many roles here today. Anyhow, and let us continue our conversation. Please join us for the reception. Food for thought will be followed by just food and maybe some discussion. And of course, we'll have also a chance there to see some slides with the wonderful work that the Niarchos Foundation is doing in Greece. And I will ask Mr. Chamis to say a few words there. So please join us for the reception. Thanks again for being with us this evening. We really appreciate it.